Good afternoon, everyone. Happy Victoria Day weekend, and welcome to Blessed Frederick Ozanam Parish as we gather as one family on this great solemnity of Pentecost for our Eucharistic celebration. We are so happy that you are able to join us today and extend a warm welcome to any new parishioners or visitors. We wish to gratefully acknowledge and thank all of our dedicated volunteers, without whom this Mass and the live streaming of this Mass would not be possible. Please rise.
This Mass is being offered for the repose of the souls of Maria Chan, of Diago Sequeira, and of Reverend Paul Lennon. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome once again to our celebration on this great solemnity of Pentecost. Before we begin, let us pause for a moment of silence, call to mind our sins, and ask for the Lord's pardon and mercy. We were created by you, Lord, have mercy. We were created through you, Christ, have mercy. We were created for you, Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who willed the Paschal mystery to be encompassed as a sign in 50 days, grant that from out of the scattered nations, the confusion of many tongues may be gathered by heavenly grace into one great confession of your name. through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in their own language. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it we hear each of us in our own language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judah and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. Brothers and sisters, live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, and to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I'm warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruits of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to the disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of the Lord. Today we celebrate the great feast of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit, through the intercession and mediation of our Blessed Mother, came upon the apostles to give birth to the church, the mystical body of Christ. And last weekend we had celebrated the great feast of the Ascension, when Jesus ascended into heaven, not to leave us on our own, but to be with us and to remain with us in a way that is just as meaningful, just as powerful, and just as real as his physical presence among us some 2,000 years ago. And the way Jesus accomplishes this, the way Jesus remains with us, is through the Pentecost experience. For it is through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that the Father and the Son make their home among us and within us, making sure that we are never alone and remaining with us always. One of the things I've come to realize is how closely connected the Feast of the Ascension and Pentecost are. How, in a sense, the Ascension and Pentecost are really two sides of the same coin. Because just before Jesus ascended into his glory, the apostles gathered around him and they asked him something that I find very revealing. They asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you are going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" The reason I find this revealing is because it shows us clearly that even after the resurrection of Jesus, the apostles still didn't quite get it, and that they still hadn't really changed. That even after the resurrection and even after Jesus had appeared to them on the several occasions, they were still very focused on the things of this world and were still hoping and waiting for some kind of political solution to their suffering and the suffering of their people. In other words, the disciples were still focused on an external solution to their suffering, still focused on the establishment of the kingdom outside themselves rather than the kingdom within themselves. And so witnessing the fact that Jesus had resurrected from the dead and seeing for themselves that Jesus had completely conquered death and that everything he foretold came true may have given them a newfound sense of hope and joy, but it was still not enough to really change their perspective or change them, to take their focus off of the things of this world and onto the things of heaven, to stop them from focusing on change without and start focusing on change within instead. And so without the Pentecost event, without being clothed with power from on high by the Holy Spirit, the apostles would still be waiting in fear and hiding until the Lord's second coming. And they would still be waiting and hoping for a political solution to their plight and the plight of their people. And without the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the apostles would not have changed from men of great fear to men of great courage, from men who feared the world into men who changed the world. What this shows us is that belief in God and faith in God by itself is not really enough to change us. Like the apostles, we too need the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to really change who we are, so that we too can change the world. We can believe in God and have faith in God, but without the Pentecost experience, without being clothed with power from on high, our belief in God won't translate into any kind of meaningful change. For even if we too, like the apostles, had witnessed the resurrected Christ, and he had appeared before our very eyes, we would still need the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to truly ignite our faith and bring it alive. And so the Pentecost experience is truly an essential element of our faith journey, because without it, our faith remains lifeless. Because as the scriptures clearly tell us, it is only through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that the apostles finally get it, that they finally realize not to look outside themselves for solutions to their difficulties, and not to look outside themselves for hope and comfort. For true and lasting comfort can only be found within, and true and lasting comfort comes only from the Holy Spirit. In fact, one of the many titles given to the Holy Spirit is Comforter and Spirit of Consolation. And so the Holy Spirit is given to us by the Father and the Son, not only to remain with us, but to bring us peace and comfort, and to be our primary source of consolation in this life. During our time here on this earth, we all seek and need comfort of some kind, especially when going through hardships. And we all have things that bring us comfort during difficult times or simply after a long, hard day. But I once read an article online entitled, "Some of the Things We Do for Comfort Are Not So Comforting After All." The article explains that a lot of the things we find comfort in, such as food, media, and alcohol, only provide temporary relief, and that they can be a form of avoiding or escaping an issue rather than addressing it. The article went on to explain, and I quote, "Our culture has erroneously taught us that we should find ways to get rid of negative feelings rather than truly experience them." What this means is that in the end, these external things we find comfort in can often lead to more emotional distress, for the comfort they provide is fleeting and will eventually wear off. And because the comfort they provide is more about avoiding an issue rather than addressing it. I found this interesting because in prayer, the Lord has been calling me more and more to rely on Him alone for comfort and to let go of some of the usual methods that I use to cope with stress, which for me usually involves food and television. And so more and more I have been turning to prayer for consolation at the end of a long day rather than the fridge or television. Because food may provide some temporary relief, but it's not at all good for my waistline or for my overall health. And this is the same with all sorts of comforts we seek outside ourselves. These other sources of comfort can eventually do more harm than good, because it is only God Himself who can provide us any true, meaningful, and lasting comfort. During these uncertain times, it would be no surprise if many of us were seeking all sorts of comfort in more ways than ever, and in ways that may not be that healthy. And in all honesty, there's nothing wrong with a bit of physical comfort and consolation, as long as it's not sinful and self-destructive. But it's important to remember that our primary source of comfort should come from God Himself, and that physical comforts are only meant to complement spiritual comforts, not replace them. Because when we use physical comforts as our primary source of consolation, like the article warns, it tends to lead to the avoidance of issues and eventually more problems down the road. The world, of course, is obsessed with providing quick fixes for all our problems and in helping us to avoid negative emotions at all costs. And the world is not really interested in the benefits of spiritual consolation, something we saw clearly during the pandemic when churches were closed while the LCBO remained open. And understandably, none of us want to experience negative emotions like grief, sadness, and stress. But the key to getting to the other side of these emotions, to a place of hope, joy, and peace, is not quick fixes or avoiding and suppressing these emotions with physical comforts, but to acknowledge these feelings, address them, and walk through them with the Lord, allowing the Holy Spirit to be with us and console us in the midst of these negative emotions. For the true purpose of religion is not about avoiding pain and difficulty. It's about God Himself becoming our strength and consolation during times of pain and difficulty. And so this great feast of Pentecost invites us to ask ourselves the following questions. Where do I find my primary source of comfort? To whom or to what do I turn for consolation and strength? Is it God Himself, or is it the created goods of this world from which I seek lasting and meaningful consolation? Because if we believe in God but don't feel like our faith has really made an impact on our life and our behavior, if like the apostles before Pentecost, we are still hoping and waiting for external solutions to our pain and our problems, if we are still seeking comfort primarily from the created goods of this world, rather than from the Creator Himself, then we might need to turn to the Holy Spirit and ask Him for the help, the change, and the comfort that we are seeking. Because once again, the Lord did not ascend into heaven to leave us on our own, but in order that He could continue to comfort us and support us in a way that is even more profound and more powerful than His physical presence among us. And He does so. He does this primarily through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now let us stand and profess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Relying on the Spirit who always intercedes for us, let us turn to the Lord with our prayers of petition as we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer.
Loving God, hear our prayer. For the church, that this Pentecost may bring a renewed sense of unity in the body of Christ with all Christians around the world, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. That the Spirit of peace will put an end to war, violence, and division in our world, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. For a new outpouring of the Holy Spirit in our lives, in our families, and in our parish community, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. For our parish of Blessed Frederick Ozanam, that our community will continue to grow and thrive, both spiritually and physically, bringing to fruition our mission to build our new church in which to offer glory and praise to God, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. For all who are sick, that the breath of the Spirit's love may come upon them, restoring them to health and wholeness, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. For all who have died, that they may be welcomed with joy into the fullness of God's presence, we pray. Loving God, hear our prayer.
God, our Father, open our hearts to the gifts of your Spirit, that we may always walk in the light of your presence. We entrust all our needs and intentions to you through our Blessed Mother as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Pour out upon these gifts the blessing of your Spirit, we pray, O Lord, so that through them your church may be imbued with such love that the truth of your saving mystery may shine forth for the whole world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For bringing your Paschal mystery to completion, you bestowed the Holy Spirit today on those you made your adopted children by uniting them to your only begotten Son. This same Spirit, as the church came to birth, opened to all peoples the knowledge of God and brought together the many languages of the earth in profession of the one faith. Therefore, overcome with Paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with blessed Frederick Ozanam, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Francis our Bishop, his assistant bishops, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who were pleasing to you, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. And now at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
So this week's announcements are, there are no announcements because I forgot to put them together. So I actually ran out of time. I didn't have enough time to put them together. So please stand for the closing prayer. Let us pray. May these gifts we have consumed benefit us, O Lord, that we may always be aflame with the same Spirit whom you wondrously poured out on your apostles. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth now in the peace of Christ. The Mass is ended. Thanks be to God. Pray to St. Michael. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan, all spirits who prowl about the world. Amen. Thanks, everyone, for joining us. Hope you have all a very blessed and safe long weekend. I won't be greeting people because I have another Mass here at 7:30, and I got to get set up for that. But I wish you all a very blessed remainder of the weekend and the week ahead as well. God bless.